Fourth took on top in our LV game of the week, where Yorkshire were looking to make the most of their game in hand on Middlesex in Headingley, and they made an ideal start when Jack Brooks trapped Joe Burns in front for three in the game's fourth over. This after James Franklin opted to bat first after he won the toss. These two teams are the only unbeaten ones in this season's LV County Championship First Division, and if the weather stays fair over the next few days as expected, it's likely that one of those records will come to an end by Wednesday. It was important then, in what appeared to be good batting conditions, overhead at least, that the visitors put that early loss of Burns behind them in front of a very good weekend crowd in Leeds, the home supporters knowing the importance of this encounter. Sam Robson and Nick Compton, two former England openers playing in this game against the current one Adam Lythe and England's number three Gary Balance, were soon started to make the most of anything on offer, as they were able to add 62 runs in 21 overs for the second wicket, using up a fair amount of the morning session. Brooks switched ends, and with his fifth ball of his second spell, he produced a peach to bowl Robson for 41, the former Northamptonshire player with his 22nd championship wicket of the summer. He was certainly up for the challenge, and his reaction to his success was something we've all become used to over the last couple of very profitable seasons for the 31-year-old. He was close to going on his celebratory run soon after, another beauty proving to be even too good for a man of Compton's defensive skills. He had by now been joined by Darvin Milan, who was playing in his first championship game of the season. He played a couple of delightful drives to take his side through to a total of 83 for 2 at lunch. Six balls after the restart, Milan though was back in the pavilion after nicking off to Stephen Patterson. It was the start of an afternoon session which quickly saw the champions take control of this contest. Neil Dexter lasted only 9 balls and didn't get off the mark, Brooks off and running again as he also found the edge for wicket number 24 of the summer. Dexter out quickly after batting for nearly 4 hours without being dismissed in the draw with Warwickshire at Lord's last week. Middlesex reached three figures then with 4 men back in the hutch, and the innings of Compton now took on even more significance. This kind of situation is tailor-made for him, and he worked hard to frustrate the home attack and get into a half century, his fourth to go with his one ton in this championship season, off 126 balls from which he'd struck 7 fours. He'd moved on to 53 when Yorkshire took over after spinner Glenn Maxwell was handed the ball. His first over went for 5, but then to the second delivery of his second, he had Franklin pushing to Jack Leaning, who held on well at short leg to go for 3. 2 balls later and the Australian was being surrounded by his teammates once again. John Simpson going LBW for a duck to a ball fired in at him, a wicket which left Middlesex in a fair amount of trouble on 119 for 6, hardly the position they would have wanted to be in after winning the toss and going in first. Those who watched last week's test match here will have seen a dry pitch which offered the spinner plenty as the game wore on. Ollie Rayner decided to take a New Zealand type approach to proceedings by trying to hit his side out of trouble. 4 times in one single over from Maxwell, Rayner found the boundary. The bowler with the rather odd figures on the first afternoon of a 4-day game of 3 overs, 1 maiden, 2 for 21. That became 3 for 25 when Maxwell quickly exacted his revenge as Rayner on a 14 ball 20 was bowled to end a cameo, leaving him with his side slipping deeper into a hole on 147 for 7. 23 more runs have been added to that when Brooks came back on and once again struck early in a spell, this time bagging the big wicket of Compton, who'd made 70 in 3.5 hours, when he, having just been beaten by a ball that spat at him, drove an edge to Leaning, who held on at the second attempt. It really could not have been going much better for Yorkshire then, when Patterson won an LBW to see the back of Toby Rowland-Jones for 11, the afternoon session now being extended with the visitors 9 down with 188 runs on the board, 7 wickets falling for 105 runs in 32 overs in the middle session thus far. Tim Murta returned to the side after recovering from injury, and he and James Harris were able to stick it out for 6 overs in adding 24 for the last wicket. Brooks then securing the 9th 5-wicket haul of his career and his 2nd of this summer by having Harris held by Balance at long leg. Brooks's 5 for 44 was a season's best, in fact, and largely thanks to him, Middlesex were all out for 212 They did have 27 overs left in the day to fight back, though. And that they did, but for a while it looked as if they were going to regret this day. Lythe was back in Yorkshire colours after scoring 100 on this ground for his country last week, and he was again looking good, as he so often does at the top of the order for his county, as he and Alex Lees back together again started the Yorkshire reply by taking 29 runs off the deficit before both fell in the space of four deliveries. Lythe was the first out, edging Roland Jones to Rayner. You could see what that wicket meant to the visitors. They may have felt a little down after their batting exploits, but they were soon fighting back with the ball. Middlesex are a side who, like Yorkshire, have shown a lot of steel this summer. Murta then backed up his opening partner to give Rayner some more work to do in the slips. Lythe had made 17 and Lees 11, both men now back in the pavilion with just 29 runs on the board. Seven later, and balance was LBW to Murta. The batsman's technique will be being watched very closely right now, and the problems the left-hander has are there for people to see, especially the bowlers, who know what they need to do to get him out. Worse followed for Yorkshire when they lost their captain, Andrew Gale. He was another leg-before victim, this time to Harris, the 14th wicket of the day. A similar story right across the country. Gale was gone for 18, 52 for 4. More wickets in the 11 overs that remained in this bowler-dominated day, and Middlesex will have taken the day, it seemed. Instead, Johnny Bairstow, a man who hardly fails with the bat these days, and Jack Leaning, about whom you can say exactly the same, managed to remove any more threats before stumps were drawn. Both hit the ball as cleanly as anyone as they added 44 runs to the total before the close. After it, the heroes of day one gave their assessment of both the pitch and the day's play.
Yeah, not a minefield. I mean, it's always enjoyable playing on wickets like that because you really have to earn every run. I think it's a Yorkshire attack that we know have a lot of discipline. And it was a case of being very patient and trying to take the runs that you could get. I think 200 was an okay score, but I think 250, 260 would have been even better. So put it this way, I wouldn't really want to be batting last on it.
It's not an easy wicket to start on. And if you put the ball in good areas with their bowling attack, they've got a good bowling attack. It's not easy. And so you've got to get in, stay in on it. It's kind of one of those wickets when the ball gets a bit older and the wicket can get a bit flatter and the sun gets on it, you can feel your boots. Hopefully we can bat past them and get a decent total, otherwise it could end up being an interesting game.